Hi, this is George Lynch from Doc and Lynch Mob, Souls of We, and you're listening to Focus on Metal. Focus on
Hey, Metalheads, Scott Thompson here, welcoming you to episode 577 of that which we call Focus on Metal. Wow, you know it's going to be an off day when you're getting ready to do an episode and you go to turn on all the studio equipment and you're just staring at the main breaker and having like a total brain fart of what the hell to do. But anyways, see how this one goes. This is another one of those Richie drop-ins. You know, we weren't sure whether we were going to get another episode out before the end of November. But, hey, you know, this will be one. Who knows? Maybe we'll get another one out between now and the end of the month. But Richie was able to hook up with the legendary Mr. Scary himself, George Lynch. Now, I know we've had George on the show before. I think, actually, though, I didn't interview him. I know Richie didn't interview him, so it may have been an interview that John Caddick did for us. John, if those of you don't know, he is the guy who is the host of Iron City Rocks. Go check out that show. But I think it was actually an interview that John did way back in the day. But in this case, Richie was able to get on the line with George, have a great chat with him about all things going on with Lynch Mob. Definitely a lot of good stuff going on with Lynch Mob. As I mentioned before, I think talking to Richie on one of the shows, you know, I was able to catch Lynch Mob back in June of this year at a small club in Worcester. It was great. And, you know, they were doing some deep tracks. They were doing stuff off the new album that had yet to be released. Good, solid show. Gabriel can definitely deliver on the vocals. Very tight band. A lot of good jammy vibe there as well. And as Jimmy DeAnda can attest, there is definitely times when George just decides he wants to go off and do something right in the middle of a set. I know we talked to Jimmy about that up at, I want to say Salisbury. There's Lynch Mob show up at Salisbury that Richie and I went to. I can't remember how many years ago that was, but that was actually an excellent show as well, except for the fact that Yoni was reading lyrics out of a book. But good show, but I will say, and I said it in the show notes as well, you can always get show notes at focusonmetalpod.com. But in the show notes, I even said this is probably my second favorite Lynch Mob show that I had been to. The first, obviously, being the OG Wicked Sensation tour way back in the day at a small bar down in Boston with Love, Sex, Death opening for them. That was just a high energy, insane show. Everybody was really excited about George being back out there, the new Lynch Mob album, all of that. But this one, I will say, if I were to rank all of my many, many Lynch Mob shows, that the one I saw back in June with the new lineup is my second favorite mob show. So George will be talking about touring, actually talking, unfortunately, about what looks like might be the end of touring in early 2025 for Lynch Mob. But the intent of, as he says, going out with a bang, which would include just really insane, great shows like the one I saw, and pulling in the new music off of Babylon as well, which is a great Lynch Mob release. You never know what you're going to get. And I told Richie about this too. I said, you know, definitely I was not disappointed with what I heard on Babylon. All good, solid songs. And, you know, it brought me right back to what I saw in June and what I was hoping the rest of the album would be like with the few songs I heard live. And yeah, again, did not disappoint. And also, you know, the last couple shows, they have been running pretty freaking long. And this one, not the case. So you guys should be in and out of here in about 30 minutes this week. But within there, lots of great stuff from George. Definitely in high spirits, willing to talk candidly about stuff. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Richie and our guest this week, George Lynch.
Hello.
Hey, is that George?
Yes.
Hey, George, it's Richie here for the interview. How are you doing?
Very well. How about yourself?
I'm okay. I'm looking forward to this one. I've never interviewed you. I've been doing the show for about 10 years. So I got a lot of questions. So
hopefully I'll have some answers for you.
Yeah, hopefully some you might have been asked before. I think one in particular, but we'll get to that. First question I have is, have you ever gotten rid of a guitar and regretted it?
Oh, many. Boy, how much time you got? Yeah, but very quickly, my first real guitar, you know, which was a 1960 Les Paul Special, that was stolen. But that was my first guitar that I fell in love with and really defined me and my playing and everything. So I really felt it was an extension of myself. I mean, it was just part of me. And I just never thought I'd play anything other than that guitar for the rest of my life. And it got stolen, as I said. So I lost something there that was very magical, I thought. It took me a while to... I never got back to that place with a guitar.
Okay.
And then I had a... You know, there's been others as well. I had a 1954 Gold Top Les Paul that I traded to Don Dokken for a car for one of my kids. We needed a car to, you know, get to work, go to school, stuff mm-hmm. like that. And the 55 Gold Top is probably worth $100,000 right now. The car that he traded me, which he said was rebuilt and super dependable, was a Mitsubishi, some 80s Mitsubishi Laser. It was like one of the worst cars ever built in history. And it literally lasted 2 days. And my daughter just abandoned it. We had to have it dragged to the we tried to get to the mechanic. We took it to the mechanic. Don said he had it all fixed up at. And they said they'd never heard of him before, that he brought it in. But he had him put sawdust in something or other to plug it up temporarily so he could get rid of it to some unsuspecting sucker, which was me. So he got the Gold Top Les Paul and I got screwed.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So years ago, I remember reading an interview in Kerrang when you were promoting Wicked Sensation, and the guy asked you what made you a great guitar player. And I always remember your answer is that you didn't consider yourself a great guitar player and didn't even know if you were a good guitarist. How would you answer that question now?
Well, I mean, it's complicated. It's not that simple. I mean, technically, am I a great guitar player? No. Do I have something to say? Yeah. You know, I think that's pretty much sums it up. Okay. I mean, I have a voice and I have a kind of a, my own personal way of talking on the guitar or whatever you call it. So, and I have ideas in my head that I translate that I don't translate very well, but I attempt to translate into reality through my instrument.
Okay. Okay.
But you know, it's really, I don't think a guitar is just a technique thing or solos. It's like everything. It's the whole package. It's like, you know, you're a composer, you're an improviser, you're a soloist, and I provide vehicles for other musicians and instruments to kind of do their thing, which I also love drums and vocals. You know, I listen to singers more than I listen to guitar players. So, and just the craft of composition is, to me, even much more important. And people, you know, my wife asked me the other night, she goes, how many songs you think you've written? I go, probably, you know, I don't know, you know, 1,000 or something. Who knows? And she goes, well, that's pretty great. I go, well, actually, you know, I'd prefer if I had written one great song.
Mm. So you'd rather be remembered, George, as a great songwriter than a great guitarist.
Well, I wouldn't even pigeonhole into categories. I just, you know,
it's the whole thing. And then,
yeah. There's really no way to kind of separate things. Like people go, well, you know, you're a good rhythm player and a lead player. I go, well, I don't look at them as being, you know, there's so much, there's just, everything's a gray area.
Yeah.
So I come, you know, from the era of, you know, bands just kind of do everything themselves and, you know, they're self-produced, they compose their own songs, they arrange their own material, they do their own stage show, they do their own, you know, figure out how to play and, you know, everything, you know. So it's not just being a guitar player, it's kind of the whole, you're just this kind of complete musical package thing that, you know, you don't rely on other people and you have this very personal identity and vision. And you know, I've had marginal success, so that's good enough for me. And I'm very happy with that. And I feel very fortunate. You know, but I'm, no aspirations to be the world's greatest technical guitar player or anything like that, you know.
Do you feel sometimes, George, over the years that people just pressure you to, they want to see you play fast and shred, and there's a lot more to guitar playing than that?
Well, it's one of the things.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is one of the things. It's very important and it's very exhilarating, and we all love doing it. But, you know, I've lived through eras of guitar shreddery, you know, that ended up working itself into a corner, you know, or the whole movement, you know, and then you have some paradigm shift and all of a sudden it's not cool anymore. Because really, where does it lead you? You know, you do 32nd notes and your ring day, and then what comes next? 64th notes? It's impossible. So, I mean, who cares at that point? And then people are just starving for, listen to that. I just want to hear some blues or some Tom Petty or some ZZ Top.
Yeah.
It's exhausting.
You want a song.
And it's really not satisfying, you know.
Yeah.
So, but then on the other end, you listen to something, you know, more laid back or more 70s or root or classic rock or blues based, and it's cool, but then you want to see it kind of evolve too and get a little more exciting, you know. So, you know, like a Gary Moore would do to it or something. So there's that. Okay. And so I think there's a sweet spot between, listen, we don't want to just all be stuck playing, you know, whatever, simple blues music. But at the same time, we just don't want everything to be a vehicle for a shred fest, because that's kind of ridiculous too. It's just guitar players trying to impress other guitar players. It's kind of not really the point of music. Shouldn't be. Yeah. So that for a small subset, you know.
Mm.
But yeah.
Yeah. So George, when you resurrected Lynch Mob, was the intention solely to do live shows, or did you know at the time you were going to do a new studio album?
Oh, with the current version?
Yeah.
I really wasn't thinking about a record initially. You know, just wanted to continue to tour and fulfill my obligations on that end. And that's my one touring vehicle. It always pretty much has been for many, many decades now. So I always needed a Lynch Mob, you know, and it's been a revolving door. And I've learned to accept that. But then after we got Jaron in the band and Gabriel, Jimmy and I said, you know, this is a really good band. This is great. And it's kind of got its own thing. And we didn't think it was going anywhere. Everybody looked like everybody was going to hang in there. So we went through sort of a dry period, you know, of not as much touring as we'd like. And we survived that. And we thought, well, this band sounds so good. We got a little time off. Let's do a record. So we did. It came out sounding unique, I thought. You know, like, this isn't chasing Wicked Sensation Lynch Mob. This is kind of just is what it is, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly because of Gabriel, you know, and his unique sound to his voice and style and everything. So once the record came out, we go, you know, I really don't want to suffer through another revolving door, you know, Page Turner in this band. You know, let's end it on a high note. So let's do another year of touring and let's tour our asses off and let everybody come out and see us, and we'll widen the set and we'll play deep tracks and we'll play shit from wherever we want to. We're just going to mix it up. We'll add some production to the show. Let's go out with a bang instead of a whimper, and on our terms. And I think that made sense for everybody. Let's just hit it hard in 2024. And actually, our last show will be Monsters of Rock Cruise in early March 2025. That'll be our last show.
Mm. Did you even approach Oni to see if he wanted to come back, George?
No, I didn't. I have done that many, many times in my life, and never really worked out. So
okay,
yeah. I mean, it's like, you know, getting back with the old. With the ex.
Yeah,
you know?
I hear you.
And after three times, four times, it's like, okay, I know what's going to happen here.
Okay.
A little honeymoon period, and that's going to ride back, same old, same old. So.
Okay. So
I'm too old for the same old, same old.
So who found Gabriel?
The president of the label that we've been working with.
Okay.
Knew of him and kept bringing him to my attention, and I stupidly didn't follow through because I don't even know why. It wasn't that I liked him, you know. I liked what I heard and everything, and we talked on the phone. But I just, for some reason, just didn't ever follow through with him. And I had a couple opportunities to, and I just dropped the ball. And I couldn't even tell you why. I'm not sure. I think I was just, my attention was all over the map. I was dealing with a lot of different projects and things. So, but eventually, of course, obviously, it did work out. He came up to the house, and we sat around in my studio here, just, you know, strumming on acoustic guitars and playing bongos, and he was just, he was a natural. I was like, holy shit. Yeah, you know, he wasn't hiding behind nothing, man. He was just right there in the room. You know, my wife and kids all coming, looking around, like, what the hell is that? And everybody dug it, you know.
Nice. George, can you remember the first song you wrote with him?
I don't remember which was the first song. I'm sorry.
Okay. So when you're writing, do you write for a specific project? Because you had the solo record came out recently, and you had Sweet Lynch earlier in the year, or do you just write?
No, I write for the project, absolutely. Now, there's some spillover, obviously.
Yeah.
Because I'm doing back-to-back stuff, but I'm not perfect, so I'll forget. And I'm like, oh, shit, I played that riff on the last record, god damn it. But generally, you know, it's going to sound... the sound of everything is going to be dictated by the members in that band. You know, KXM does a record. I mean, it's not going to sound like Lynch Mob. Gabriel has his own sound, and you know, I'll take one riff and I'll give it to Oni, and I'll take the same riff and give it to Gabriel, and now we'll have two different songs. And you may not even recognize that the underlying music is the same.
Okay.
So it's really very dependent on the vocals. So when I write, I subconsciously write, or semi-consciously write specifically to leave things, to create a bed for a singer. And I'm hearing melodies, you know, I'm hearing vocal melodies in my head. In my mind, I'm the world's greatest singer. I just can't, when I open my mouth, nothing comes out, but I hear it. I hear what all the greats would do, you know, I mean, Paul Rogers, or Al Green, or this guy or that guy, you know, Halford, whatever. You know, I hear it in my head. I go, oh, that's what I would want to sing over. And that's how I write.
Yeah. Did Gabriel take any of the songs or in a different direction than you might have envisioned in your head when it came to melodies and vocals?
Yeah, well, yeah, but, the whole band was involved with the melodies. So it wasn't, you know, I work with two different kinds of singers. Some singers are completely self-contained, and they just take it and they come back and it's done. Others, or it's a community effort, you know, and it was a community effort with not taking anything away from Gabriel. It's wonderful, but it's a lot of work. I mean, you look at it, you go, 11 songs of, you know, 3-4 different parts of songs, a lot of words. You got to come up with hooks. You got to come up with great lyrics that tell stories, and it's poetry and it's catchy. And it's like, man, you got to be a genius to do that. You know, I don't know. I haven't worked with a lot of people that can do that, but do it well.
Mm.
So it was a sort of a combined effort, everybody's efforts together equally to come up with these melodies and these lyrics. I have some input. I'm not a singer, so I can't really get my ideas across very easily, but I'll listen and like, for instance, Time After Time was not the chorus. That wasn't the hook in the song. They had something else. It wasn't anything really. I just kind of like, how's that even a chorus, you know? But I heard those words somewhere else in the song. I go, those words work for Sidney Lopner. It'll work for us. Come on. So, it might just be some little thing like that, but it'll change the song dramatically. You know, so everybody, you know, we don't discount anybody's ideas. All the good ideas rise to the top.
Mm. You ever suffered writer's block, George?
I used to. In the 70s and the 80s. But progressively less as the years went by. And I really can't remember having that happen to me in... recent, I mean, I didn't even know in the last 20 years if I've had that happen. Thankfully.
Yeah,
it's not fun.
That's probably one of the reasons you're so prolific. You don't suffer.
Well, and I figured, if the ideas are coming, why stifle them? I mean, because they might not be around. I might not be around. Who knows? You know, I can get run over by a bus or freaking have my left arm faded in the paint box, and then I better play while I can, you know. And if the ideas are flowing, don't put a cork in it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, in your opinion, what Lynch Mob album is underrated?
Rebel.
You think so? Okay.
Without a doubt.
Okay. Any particular reason why you think that didn't click with fans?
Oh, it was a completely business reason. It was because the label, self-admittedly, dropped the ball because they were changing distribution. It's kind of a wonky answer, and it just gets into the weeds with, you know, the business of getting records out there and distributed and so forth. But they were organizing a new distribution network with Sony, and this took longer than anticipated, and the whole thing kind of fell apart, and then they had to get it back together. Well, our record came out in the middle of that. They had virtually no distribution and had other things they were thinking about, so they just kind of got quietly released and ignored, which was tragic because Oni and I thought that was our best record since Wicked Sensation. I still believe that. And so it has recently, and also very quietly, been re-released with a different cover this year.
Okay.
Under a different label, under Deadline Cleopatra.
Okay. Re-released. Nice. Now, George, you can probably tell I'm from Ireland, and this is the one docking question I have for you. What are your memories in the mid-80s of the tour bus getting burnt out in Belfast when you're on tour with Accept?
Yeah, I almost spent the night in that thing, because that whole tour, I made my room, the little cubby under the stairs, which is kind of, I don't know if you know what that is, in those old Van Hools, I think they are.
Mm-hmm.
But they had there's a little trap door when you open the door to go walk up the stairs to go into the bus. There's a little trap door to the left, and you go in that trap door, and there's a whole kind of area in there, and it had mattress in there, and you could open a little window and look outside and watch the world go by, and I have to deal with anybody. So that was my little private space. And the hotel that we checked in was all razor concertina wire, guard dogs, guards, armed guards, you know, because there had been many bombings at that hotel and lots of other places, you know, sandbags, and you had to go through this perimeter security, and it was just brutal. So I usually didn't even bother with the hotels. I would just spend the night in the bus, but that night I didn't for some reason. And then we woke up the next morning and it was burnt to the wheels. I mean, I would have been toast.
You must have lost your, I'm sure there's probably wallets, passports, everything on the bus.
I don't remember.
Okay.
I don't remember. I don't remember having any issues like that, so I don't think we did. I think we had everything with us, but because we needed our passports to get into the hotel.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. Now, there was a rumor circulated in Ireland around the time of Wicked Sensation, and because you were out touring with Queensryche. And you never did the show in Dublin. And the rumor was that you didn't want to do the show in Ireland because of what happened with the tour bus a few years before that. Is there any truth to that?
I have no recollection of that at all.
It must be only a rumor then.
I don't know. I mean, I don't have a recollection one way or the other of whether it's the first time I've ever heard that, even that question or thought about it. It might be true. I don't know.
Yeah.
That's, what is that, 35 years ago, 40 years ago?
I just remember showing up at the Dublin show. And
yeah.
Lynch Mob, at the time, it was a lot harder to find out who was playing at certain venues because pre-internet. And some local band came on, and I was like, ah, fuck, because I was hoping it was going to be you guys. And you did all the UK shows except for the Dublin one. And then the rumor started going around back home that you didn't want it, that, you know, that George didn't want to do it because of the bus being burnt out in Belfast a few years before.
Yeah, that might have. I don't know about that.
Okay.
I don't know. That doesn't sound like me. But although, okay, you know, I sometimes I'm a little bit of a chicken. Like when we played, Dokken played, we were playing in like an Eastern Europe when Chernobyl melted down.
Oh, wow.
And we were kind of headed towards Sweden, I believe. Things got canceled, so we were supposed to go to Sweden and fly. But the cloud was coming over, you know, the radiated cloud and all this stuff. And I mean, it was scary because, again, pre-internet, nobody really knew anything. You know, I was hearing things from my crew that the core of the Earth was melting down, and I just wanted to be with my family. And I, okay, well, this is not more important than my family. I'm going home. So I went to Frankfurt Airport and found a way to get to Frankfurt Airport and took off. Okay. And went home, canceled the tour. But thinking, you know, that the world was ending, I wanted to die with my family, not with Don Dokken. And
yeah.
But of course, the world didn't end. And of course, you know, I looked like I had egg all over my face. I was a dummy.
Yeah. So, George, tell everyone where they can get a copy of the record.
Oh, well, I have them in the back of my trunk. In my 73 Pino. No, in my Mitsubishi Laser that Don Dokken sold me. Yeah. No. All, you know, everywhere, I guess. Yeah. You know, I don't even know how people buy records anymore, quite honestly. iTunes, whatever that's called, Apple Music, streaming.
Yeah.
Well, hard to say.
Well, George, the album's excellent. If it's the last Lynch Mob record, which I think it will be, it's a good one to go out on.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that.
So it's been a pleasure talking to you.
You as well. Yeah, Thank you.
And have a good rest of the day.
You too, sir.
Okay, take care. Bye.
All right, big thanks to our guest this week, George Lynch. And if you haven't done it already, do yourself a favor. Go out and pick yourself up a copy of Babylon. Lots of good stuff on there. And if you like Lynch Mob, you're really going to like this album. And as I said before, go out and freaking catch them live. If this is, like George is saying in that interview, the final tour of Lynch Mob, is a great lineup here. They're all super talented. They play really well together. High energy, great stuff. You're going to probably hear stuff live that you've never heard before. You didn't ever expect to hear live. Like a lot of us, you know, me, a lot of people included in the June show, were shocked to be hearing stuff off of Smoke and Mirrors. So go out, catch them. And you will not be disappointed. And speaking of not disappointed, you know, I just got to go into a little bit of a gear thing here because I've been super excited with a lot of the guitar gear that's been coming out lately. And I have to say the new MXR Wild Audio pedals, great stuff. I got all three of the new ones. I've got all the old ones as well. Great stuff. Well worth having if you are a pedal addict like I am. But another killer one that just came out probably in the last, I want to say, maybe 3 weeks is the Universal Audio Lion 68. Incredible pedal. If you like the dual super lead sound or the super bass sound, you get all of that in this pedal. And the reason I bought it, true disclosure, is it does a phenomenal 1978 Eddie Van Halen Marshall sound. So now with this and with the other, you know, MXR Eddie pedals that I have, I can get that 78 Eddie stuff, and then I can get the latter stuff from Eddie with the brand new Boss STE 3000 EVH and the 5150 pedal. So cover each one of those. And actually, it was pretty cool. Able to go out and see Mammoth WVH last week. Phenomenal show, you know, right up on the rail, and able to check out all of what was on Wolfie's pedal board and the other guys in the band as well. And it's a lot of the same EVH pedals that I have as well. And there's another one too. If you have a chance to catch Mammoth WVH, do it. I know, you know, they're going to be doing a lot of support dates coming up with the M72 tour, you know. They'll be at the date that I'm on as well, but catching them in a small club, phenomenal. Between them and Nita Strauss, who opened for them, catching those people in a small, packed club was pretty damn awesome. So it looks like I'm going to be able to get this one mixed, mastered, and pushed out before the Thanksgiving holiday. So that's good. Get this one out for November, and that means that I can then enjoy my holiday weekend heading out to the traditional thing that I do every year, which is to go check out TSO. They always play up the road in Manchester the Friday after Thanksgiving. They always play the Saturday afterwards in Worcester. I'm going to be checking them out Saturday night in Worcester. So I'm sure that Joel and Chris and everybody else will be putting on another killer kick-ass show. Looking forward to that. So if you're going to the Worcester show, Focus on Metal will be in the house for the late show. But for this week, that's it. There ain't no more stick a fork in it. This puppy is done. So for Richie and myself, have yourselves a great metal week. And until we talk to you again, as always, remember,
focus on metal.
Everything else is insignificant.
Still here? It's over. Go home.